Sorry, I forgot to put my capo on. I call this my Superman cape. My Superman capo. Try it again. That's what the angels pronounced, and that's what the Word of God tells us. Praise the Lord. So glad that you're here today. I'll tell you what, stand up and let somebody know how glad that you're here, okay? Or just reach over and let somebody praise the Lord. To the world. Great joy in our hearts. Praise the Lord. Well, the ladies had a great time shopping on Thursday. They had a great time and made it home, made it there safely and made it home, made it back safely and had a great time, heard good reports, good news. We want to thank Marianne for driving them safely over there and so on. So we just praise God for that. Also want to thank all those who helped with the property this last week with the cleaning up and doing some of the firewising. We're going to be continuing to do that firewising on the property. If you want to help out with any of that, you're of course welcome to do that. Men had a great time at the breakfast yesterday, great devotional, just a great spirit that God is blessing our church. Of course, the men are meeting every Wednesday at 10 o'clock at the Pinon Cafe. Come on out for that. And the Women's Fellowship is coming up. Are you doing something this coming Thursday, or is it the Thursday afterwards? A gift exchange or something? You want to say something about
that? Well, we usually do it on the first and the third Thursday. And so the only thing that we are up against this Thursday is the fact that they are having a graduation here at 11 o'clock. So It might be to our advantage to do it the next week, but that's awfully close to Christmas. So if we do it this week, is this an issue with someone? Would you rather do it next week? If you'd rather do it next week, raise your hand. If you'd rather do it this week, don't raise your hand. So if you'd rather do it next week, raise your hand. If you'd rather do it this week, raise your hand. So we'll go ahead and we'll do it this week, but what we'll do is we'll meet in the children's wing. And so there's stuff back there, there's a refrigerator and everything, so we're fine back there. So we will meet this Thursday, and we will meet at 10:30, and we will go till noon. And what we do is we have a devotional, and then we play games.
Yeah.
But this time, we'll have a devotional, and we'll do a gift exchange, and then if we have more time, we will still play games. Okay, so anyway, this Thursday at 10:30.
And the reason it'll be in the back is because Gila Community College is having their nurses' graduation right here in the sanctuary that morning. So they'll be busy using this facility here for their nurses' pinning and their graduation of the new class of nurses. So that's a great thing. Amen? I'm glad that we have this facility, and they love the beauty of our facility, so it'll be a great time. So this coming Thursday, Christmas Eve candlelight service is coming up. It is on Christmas Eve, which is December 24th. Somebody actually asked me, what day is Christmas Eve? And I said, December 24th, the day before Christmas. And they said, no, what day? And I said, oh, Friday, okay. Friday, yeah, now I know what you mean. So Friday evening, 6 o'clock, we'll have just a really, really beautiful scripture readings and singing of the great Christmas hymns and so on, all telling the story about Christ being the light of the world and how we're to take that light out in the world. So use that as an opportunity to invite your friends. Of course, I would hope that you would invite your family and friends all the time. But when we have special events like that, people are very much open these days. They're seeing what's happening in the world, and it is a proven fact. Surveys have shown people are far more receptive right now to an invitation than in many, many years. So take advantage of this time, invite somebody, and help them to come to faith in Christ as well. As always, we want to thank you for your generosity and your giving and blessing the church and helping the church to continue to do the work of the kingdom, not only here but around the world. So I want to thank you for that, whether it be online or in the yellow box in the back. Feel free to give and be a part of the kingdom building business around the world. It does last for all eternity. Everything you do is eternal and for the kingdom of God. We want to wish Dan and Christy Horsley a happy anniversary this week on Friday, I believe, which is Christmas Eve, right?
No, it's the
17th. Huh?
The week before.
Oh, okay. Man, I am so far. I'm just anticipating. Yeah, this Friday, that's right. This Friday is not Christmas Eve. Somebody remind me that this Friday is not Christmas Eve, okay? What's that?
When is Christmas Eve?
It doesn't get any better.
This morning.
We want to make sure Leah and her family, they are here.
Oh, okay. Hey, introduce your family.
Leah.
Hey. Hey, hey, pay attention. Introduce your family that are here. Here, let me give you the microphone.
Okay.
Thank you. My wife made mention. There you go. Come on in.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Are we on? Yes. Many of you have seen our daughter Heather join us. This is her twin sister Sarah. She's been a missionary with her husband, who's a pastor in Indonesia, for the last 11, 12 years there. And she is now moving here, and we are awaiting the spousal visa to be granted for her husband. He's working in Sumatra right now as a pastor there, waiting for the spousal visa. But we have little AJ and little Ruby, their children, with us this morning, and we're just overwhelmed with joy and happiness. For, yeah, wonderful. So
great.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor.
We want to welcome you, and we're glad that you have decided to make that move here. Amen to that?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Let's turn now to our responsive reading. I'll read the light-colored print, and then you'll read whenever you see the bold print, you'll read that. This morning, we light the candle of joy. True joy is deep and abiding, rich and rewarding. True joy comes from a deep well within that does not run dry when trouble comes. We seek joy in our lives, and we seek to share joy with those around us. This world's culture is driven by consumerism. Consume more and you will be fulfilled. Consume more and you will be happy. Consume more and you will have worth. When we allow ourselves to be captivated by this worldly spirit, we will never find true joy. May we find contentment in what we have, view others as potentially becoming God's much-loved children, so that we might know true joy. Joy is found not in consuming more. Joy is found in the transformed life. This new life is one of generosity, compassion, and care for those around us. May we feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and have compassion on all so that we might know true joy. We are now invited into this new way of living and doing so that we can become people of joy. This doing involves sharing, giving, respecting, honoring, and caring for people around us. Joy comes when we learn to hold what we have lightly so that we can give freely. Joy comes in truly showing love to others. May the light of joy consume our hearts as we allow Christ to transform us into generous people of joy. And all the people said,
Amen.
Amen. Let's sing together, shall we? Think about the night that Jesus was born and the shepherds appearing and the angels appearing, announcing great news of great joy that will be for all the people. And the scripture says, and on earth peace on whom his favor rests. We know that that joy comes and that peace can only come in the hearts of those on whom God's favor rests. Amen? A lot of people leave that part out when they say, and peace on earth. And we talk about peace being on the earth, but the scripture very clearly says, in whom his favor rests. So the real joy comes when we know that we are in the favor of God and in a right relationship with God. Amen? Let's sing about that. Sometimes we don't want to be too undignified in church, right? We don't want to be too undignified. And I say sometimes you just need to kind of let it out and be joyful. The scripture says the joy of the Lord is our strength. Amen? The joy of the Lord that we have in our hearts, that's our strength. Let's sing about that now. Now, when we get to the fourth verse, I hope you don't mind, we're going to get a little undignified. And I hope that you'll participate because you have joy in your heart too. Amen? The joy of the Lord.
My strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy.
great. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. Well, we need to be a joyful people. We live in a world that is so unjoyful, it seems like, these days. So we need to be people of great joy. Turn with me in your Bibles, if you would, please, to once again to the book of Luke, looking in chapter 3. Luke chapter 3. We're going to be reading verses 7 through. We focused on the first part of Luke last week. We're going to be looking at verses 7 through 18 today. Would you stand with me, please, in honor of the reading of God's word? Luke chapter 3, verses 7 through 18. How many of you are enjoying the devotional study, the devotional books? Aren't they great? They are just wonderful, so spirit-inspiring. I have one book left, if somebody doesn't have one. One book, but it'll cost you. At least dinner. Okay, we'll make sure you get one. All right, see me afterwards. All right, the joy of the Lord. Luke chapter 3, verse 7 through 18. John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers." A great way to begin a message on joy, isn't it? "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not begin to say to yourselves, 'Well, we have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you that out of these stones God could raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire." "What should we do then?" the crowd asked. John answered, "Anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none, and anyone who has food should do the same." Even tax collectors came to be baptized. "Teacher," they asked, "what should we do?" "Don't collect any more than you are required to," he told them. Then some soldiers asked him, "And what should we do?" He replied, "Don't extort money, and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay." The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, "I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I'm not even worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." And with many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed the good news to them. Once again, Father, we humbly bow before you. This Christmas season, as always, we want you to feed us with the truth of your word and help us to fall before you in worship by honoring your word in our hearts and doing the kingdom. Your word tells us not to be just hearers only, but doers of the word. And our world needs a lot of joy these days. So begin in us, Lord, and help us then to spread that joy with others by the things that we do as well as the things that we say. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you. Thank you. You may be seated. Our theme this week, if you haven't already figured out, is joy. We lit the candle of joy. So it's really, really appropriate that the text begins with John the Baptist calling the crowds a bunch of snakes. That ought to bring some joy. A brood of vipers. Strange way to begin a conversation about joy, isn't it? However, when you look, take a closer examination at the Word of God. When you really look into it, the text will show us that it's really not an odd way to start a conversation about joy at all. Let me explain. First of all, you know that we have a tendency of explaining the word joy in terms of temporary, fleeting happiness, if you will. Kind of rose-colored glasses, we tend to define joy as a state of temporary emotional happiness. Floating bubbles and sparkling glitter, you know. And circumstances have to be just right if there's joy in our hearts. But joy, as we've already seen, is something much, much deeper than that. Joy, true joy, goes way beyond just a momentary feeling of happiness. If we say we're for a second, for a moment, well, I'm happy now, but wait until what comes next, then that's not really true joy, is it? True joy is much, much deeper than that. It is deeply rooted in your sense of identity. It is deeply rooted in who you are as a person and in your relationship with God. True joy is about who you are in your own identity, your own spirit, and in your connectedness with God. That's where true joy comes from. We lit the candle of hope and peace and now joy on the Advent wreath. True hope as we saw, true peace as we saw, and true joy, they're very, very directly related to each other, and they are connected with your relationship with God. So let's take a closer look at the scripture and find this pathway to joy, shall we? The first thing that we see is the way to joy begins with what? Repentance. The way to true joy in your heart, lasting, deep, settled joy in your heart, begins with a spirit of repentance. Just like true peace with God only begins with a repentant heart before God, the way to experiencing true joy begins with repentance. We see John's harsh words were actually a call to repentance. They sound so harsh, they sound so stern, but they're actually a call to repent. We often think of repentance as saying, I'm sorry. And sometimes we say, I'm sorry when we get caught. We're not really sorry, but we get caught and we go, oh, I'm sorry. But not really mean it. No real heart change. No real life change. The Greek word metanoia means so much more than that. It's about seeing things in a whole new way. It's about a life transformation. It's about a complete reorientation of your thought process, a complete reorientation, a transformation of your heart and your life. We know that the Jewish leaders, the religious leaders, they had been hearing about John the Baptist. They've been hearing about this new teaching of his and the thousands of people that were coming to John, and that made him a little bit upset, and how John was getting so much attention. And so they sent a delegation to investigate. They were going to check John out. John sees them coming, and he was immediately led by the Holy Spirit to call them all a bunch of offspring of snakes, right? What John was really saying in a figurative sense to these religious leaders is that they were dangerous and poisonous and threats to society. He was basically saying they're all a bunch of hypocrites. He was basically telling them, you say one thing, but you're living a whole different life. You say one thing, you act religious and you say religious stuff, but your life is saying something entirely different, and you're a threat to society. You're poisonous to society. That's basically what he was saying. John, totally exposed by being led by the Holy Spirit, he totally exposed how they had depended on their family religious background for their sense of righteousness with God. They had been relying on their family religious background, their family heritage, if you will, supposedly like that's what makes them right with God. They brag about being children of Abraham there in Luke chapter 3, verse 8, as though that their ancestry, their family connection, that's what saves them and makes them right with God. But John says, you're not part of the family of God at all. You're actually a family and offspring of snakes. Harsh words. Children of snakes instead of children of Abraham. See, John is trying to tell them that God has called his people out to be so much more. John was saying that God's family is so much better than that, so much greater than that. John is trying to tell them that their lives were producing fruit that was not showing that they were actually children of Abraham or children of God. Their lives were producing not the fruit of true children of God. If they were really children of God, then their lives would be producing the fruit of peace and mercy and joy and compassion and honesty and integrity and love. But we see that their lives were more lives of self-righteousness, self-focus, religious pride, harsh judgment of others, divisiveness and cheating and bullying, and the list goes on. Their lives were not producing the fruit that showed that they were truly children of God, but instead children of snakes. And so John tells them plainly, the axe is already at the door, already at the root. The axe is already taking aim, and you are about to be cut down unless you repent and return to God. We see that the call to repentance points to a new family that God wants to create through faith in Jesus. True repentance points to a new family that God wants to create through faith in Jesus. The Jews thought that they were automatically a part of the kingdom of God, if you will, that they were automatically righteous as a part of God's family because of their family heritage, their ancestral bloodline. It's kind of like one of us saying, well, I'm a Christian because my parents are Christians. Or I go to church because my parents go to church. And that's what makes me right with God. That's what makes me righteous, because my parents, kind of the same thing. Folks, Jesus came to create the true family of God, not based on your parents or your religious background or your ancestral history or your ancestral bloodlines or your race or your color or your creed or whatever. Jesus came to create a new family based on your own personal repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. He came to create a family based on your own relationship with God and the lives lived following after him. God's family is created through the cleansing waters of personal repentance, personal faith, a baptism of true godly sorrow for your sin and selfishness and self-centeredness, true godly sorrow. Godly sorrow for all selfishness, a godly sorrow for all self-focus, self-centeredness, selfish behaviors and attitudes caused by your total self-focus. It's a repentance of self being the Lord of your life instead of our Heavenly Father being the Lord of your life. Instead of God in heaven being your one and only true God and your full, complete surrender to him and your reliance on his mercy and grace. Folks, that's the only way to true joy. That's the only way to true joy. A complete spiritual transformation of your heart and a reorientation of your life. From a life of sin and selfishness and self-centeredness to a life of being set free from all sin and following Jesus. That's the only way to true joy. True joy is deeply rooted in who you are and in your own personal relationship with God. So we see, secondly, they ask the question, well, what should we do? The answer to the question, what should we do, is what leads and can help you find that true joy. After hearing John's Spirit-inspired message, verse 10 tells us that the crowd, sensing so much conviction in their heart because of their sin, they began asking, well, what should we do? What should we do? We see in verse 12, the tax collectors asked, what should we do? They felt convicted of their sins and their selfishness and their cheating of people and their greed. They felt convicted. And they wanted something better, something more. The Roman soldiers came and said, what should we do? They realized how mean-spirited they were and how hateful they had been towards people. And they wanted something different. They wanted something new. And so we see John's clear message to them, indicating that their repentance should lead to a complete life change. Their true repentance should lead to a complete change of heart and life. He said, if you have two coats, give one to somebody who doesn't have any. That indicates a life change, doesn't it? Instead of selfishness and hoarding and greed, you're generous. He said, if you have food, share it with somebody else. He said, don't make people pay more taxes than what they owe. Once again, because of selfish greed. Don't cheat people. Don't extort people, money from people. We know that historians tell us that Roman soldiers would extort money from the people to get them off of their backs. All selfishness, all self-centered, as well as their meanness, and they extorted money from people. So John said, if you're truly repentant, no more of that. No more of that. Quit harassing people. Quit making false accusations against people. Be satisfied with what you have. I remember Paul's statement that said, I have learned the secret of being content in whatever situation I'm in. I've just learned to be content. That's the transformed heart and life. Followers of Jesus are generous. Followers of Jesus, being generous is a key component of the transformed life. Christians are to be the most generous people in the world. Giving, loving, compassionate, generous. Read Matthew chapter 25 sometime and read the parable of the sheep and the goats. Read the difference between the sheep, the followers of Jesus, and the goats, those who are still selfish and sinful. Read the eternal destiny between the two. And when you read those words, it's life transforming when you realize what the consequences of your sin will lead to. But it'll also show the consequences of a transformed heart and life. And the eternal destiny of those who are truly generous and caring and compassionate. True Christians are focused on the well-being of others. Amen? True Christians are focused not on self, but on the well-being of others. They care about people. And that brings so much joy. Greed has no place in the life of the transformed heart. Tax collectors were notorious of intentionally taking more, demanding more than what the taxes were supposed to be, and then they were pocketing, they were getting rich off of their job for selfish purposes. They were taking from others. Coveting what other people have has no place in the life of the truly transformed heart and life. We are called by God to be content with what we have. That's what leads to peace and joy. Being content with what God has blessed you with. Being content with what we have. And being kind and caring and compassionate to others. The clear expectation of those who follow Jesus is a truly transformed life. Amen. A life that bears good fruit. Ronnie's class has been talking about the vine and the branches and the kind of fruit that we should be producing if we're truly a part of the vine. Our lives are to be lived entirely different from the world. A life of contentment, a life of kindness, generosity, compassion, justice. Nearly every scientific study, I've done some studies and looked at studies on what comprises true happiness and joy. And nearly every scientific study about what true happiness is, it includes the common themes of contentment and generosity. Being content and being generous. That's what constitutes true happiness and joy. When we live a transformed life that bears good fruit that pleases God, one of the consequences will be joy. Great joy in our hearts. It's that simple. We are more joyful when we care about others. There's an old children's song, and I tried to look it up. I tried to hopefully play it, but it says, it goes like this. I think I wrote it down just so I wouldn't forget. In here somewhere. Put Jesus first and others second, then put yourself at the end of the line. That's the only way you'll find true joy. Jesus first and others second, and put yourself at the end of the line. Isn't that true? When we have that good fruit, we are more joyful when we help others, when we are compassionate to others, when we aren't continually, constantly craving more and more of this world's stuff. We tend to be more joyful. What does Galatians chapter 5 tell us about the fruit of the Spirit? Galatians chapter 5 tells us what the life of the truly Spirit-filled person is and the kind of fruit that you will produce. The first one is what? Love. What's the second one? Joy. The very second one. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And so we clearly see that lives that are controlled by the Holy Spirit will produce the good kind of fruit, and one of those is great joy. How many of you think that this world could use a whole lot more joy? Boy, right now, this world could sure use a whole lot more of it. And once again, I say to you, very seriously, in all honesty, where should people be able to see that joy? In the church. In God's people. That's where they should be seeing it. That's going to be our witness. Jesus said, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Amen? Fishers of men, because you'll be bearing that fruit of the Spirit who is within you. And then finally, we see that Jesus is the good news. Jesus himself is the good news, the joy that all people need. When the angels appeared in the heavens, they say, "I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people." And it was talking about the coming of Christ. We see in our story that the people there started thinking that John might be the Messiah because of his words of wisdom. His words were so transformative, so filled with wisdom and truth. His words were so life-giving, so transformative. And that's because John challenged the people with the truth. He challenged the people with the truth, and he called the people to something greater than what they've ever known before. But watch how John immediately points people to Jesus. He points them all to the true Messiah, Jesus. John made it clear that he was not the Messiah, but that he was merely preparing the way for the Messiah, the coming of the Messiah. And we know that John used the image of baptism to point people to Jesus. You know, the thing is the people were coming to John to be baptized by him, and they went down into the water, and John baptized them, and that was refreshing and new and different. But what did John say? "I just baptize you with water." But notice how he used baptism to point people to Jesus. He said, "But there's someone who's coming after me who is greater than I, whose shoes, sandals, I'm not even worthy to untie. He is Jesus, the Messiah, and I baptize you with water, and that's good, but someone's coming who will baptize you with the Holy Spirit, with fire." John was actually speaking to those folks in Old Testament language that they would understand. Anytime the presence of God came to the people, how did he come? How did he reveal himself? thunder and fire. Amen? So they understood that when he said, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Boy, folks, John was pointing people to Jesus as being God himself in and his presence. And when he comes, things are going to be transformed. Things are going to change. There's going to be fire when he comes. He was saying that Jesus is the presence of Almighty God himself. And so, but what John was basically saying to them is that when Jesus comes into your heart, all that spirit of selfishness and sin are going to be burned away. When Christ comes, who comes with fire, his very presence represents the burning away of all chaff. When he comes, all that spirit of selfishness and sin and self-focus and greed, it's all burned away. And your heart is truly transformed when Jesus comes. The last words in our scripture text tells us, with many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed to them the good news. What was the good news? Or should I say, who was the good news? It was Jesus, the coming of Jesus. The good news was the coming of Christ, and when Jesus comes, he would bring about a whole new order of things. John was only preparing the way. The real good news was Jesus himself, Emmanuel, God with us, coming into this world and coming into the hearts and lives of men and women and boys and girls. Folks, when Jesus comes, lives are transformed, and then true joy happens. Only when Christ comes and does that work. And it all begins with repentance of sin. There can be no transformation of heart without that true repentance. It begins with repentance. And that's why when John came and he used such harsh words, he was actually calling them to repent and to prepare the way for the coming of Christ. And when Christ comes into the heart and life is utterly transformed. And you're given that true joy. Today, you and I, we know and believe that Jesus, the Savior of the world, has already come. How many of you believe that Jesus has already come? He came to us in the person of that precious little tiny little baby boy. Even that was transformative. He came to live among us, starting out as a tiny little newborn baby boy. But he came, folks, to usher in a whole new life, a whole new family, a whole new kingdom. A kingdom other than the kingdom of this world. That's why Jesus came. And yet, here we are, we still see the world's in pretty much of a mess. 2,000 years later, Christ already came. We know that, but the world is still pretty much of a mess. Wouldn't you agree? There's still a lot of brokenness and misery all around us. And yet, here we are today talking about joy. In the midst of the mess, in the midst of the misery, great, great joy. It's kind of hard to have joy in the midst of grieving over what our world is becoming. It's hard to have joy in this so-called in-between time, if you will. This time between Christ's first coming and his second coming. And by the way, it looks like it's getting closer. So here we are in this in-between time. We see a world of great misery and pain. My heart goes out to the nearly 100 people that were killed by the tornadoes back east. And all of the pain that must be happening right now. So here we are, we're in this in-between time, Christ's first coming and Christ's second coming. We believe that Christ is coming again. When he does come, he's going to set everything straight. But in the meantime, we're kind of caught in the middle here. And that's the whole point. You and I know that Christ already came, and we believe that he was and is the Savior of the world, and that he gave his life on the cross, taking our place, so that all who believe in him are transformed from sin and death to life and hope and peace and joy. We already believe that Christ did come, and we believe that he's coming again, and now our hearts are filled with so much joy. And during this Advent season, we pray that God will continue to minister that joy in our hearts, regardless of the circumstances. But more importantly, folks, here's the thing. We need to be like John, announcing that Christ did come, and he can be their Savior too. We need to be just like John, paving the way, preparing the way, announcing to others the good news of great joy that Jesus has come and that he can be their Savior too, and they too can receive God's full pardon for all of their sins and be transformed from death to life and hope and peace. We should be sharing with others the same message as John. Prepare the way for the Lord. Prepare the way for the Lord. He came to be your Savior too, and he's coming again. Prepare the way for the Lord. We need to be like John, announcing the good news. Prepare the way for the Lord. And you too can have so much peace and hope and joy in your heart too. Prepare the way for the Lord. He's coming again. Prepare the way. In fact, I think like the words of that great hymn, joy to the world. The Lord has come. And what's the next words? Let earth receive her King. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart do what? Prepare him room. Let every heart prepare him room. Isn't that what we should be all about these days? If we want to see true joy in the hearts and lives of people, then we need to be like John, just sharing the truth. If you want to have joy, it begins by repenting of all of your sin. It begins by saying yes to Christ as your Savior, and then you too can have that true joy in your heart. We need to be like John. Prepare the way. Prepare the way for the coming of the Lord, not only now, but his coming very, very soon. Why don't we sing that song in closing? Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. And let that be our clarion call as we close this service today, this great Christmas service. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Would you stand with me as we sing this together? Joy. And anointing on these folks here today. I pray, Lord God, that you will give them courage and strength and help them to be like John, announcing out in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. And I pray, Lord, that you'll help us to realize that we cannot be saved on our family heritage or on our own supposed goodness or on any works of righteousness or anything, but Lord, we are saved through faith in Jesus and by means of repentance of our own sins, a personal relationship with God, declaring our own need of a Savior. So bless us now, Lord, each and every one of us. Help us to get it and to understand. And then, Lord, I pray that as we experience the joy in our hearts, regardless of the circumstances, that we will be a witness to others around us in the days ahead. So bless us now, Father, we pray. Bless this congregation. Bless this church family with great, great joy in the days ahead as we prepare for the Lord's soon coming. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you. May the Lord bless you. And I pray and hope that you will go in the presence of the Lord in the days ahead. And all the people said, amen and amen. God bless you. You are dismissed. Have a great day in the Lord. So glad you're here today.
Christmas, never wanna stop feeling.